Hey guys, Trev here from Spinewise, and today I want to talk to you about exercise, the injuries that come with exercise, and why that whole concept of go hard or go home is completely flawed. Okay, so I want to talk about this in detail today and just give you some background as to why this concept can actually potentially lead to injury as opposed to improved performance and better outcomes for yourself. So before we get into that though, I need you to understand a little bit about the whole mechanism of energy production so that we can understand how exercise actually works. Once you get through that, then I'll start talking to you about what the effects are and what you should do, and then I'll finish up by talking about the ways that you can go about preventing yourself getting injured and still be able to go hard without a problem. All right, so before we get going, let's have a look at our energy cycle. So this is our energy cycle here. It's commonly known as the citric acid cycle or Krebs cycle. Some people may be more aware of. So with our energy cycle, really what we're talking about is there's two ways into it. We have this big circle here, which is known as our Krebs cycle or our citric acid cycle. And the whole purpose of doing this is to produce this thing down here called energy, which is what it's all about. So we have two ways of getting into this cycle. The first way is through this top pathway, and that's all about glucose. And glucose is derived from both carbohydrate and from protein, okay? There's two ways in, carbohydrate and protein. Both of them end up resulting in insulin production and glucose production in your bloodstream. Both of them are converted into energy, to keep it simple, via this pathway. The other way we have in is via fat, which is a process known as beta oxidation. So in beta oxidation, we convert stored fats across into acetyl-CoA to spin in our Krebs cycle. We can use both of those pathways. There's no problems with that at all. The one side effect we have though is when we start using this pathway here, this process of pyruvate conversion leads to one substance that is not necessarily all that good for us, and that's a substance known as lactic acid. And whilst lactic acid can have some benefits, like we use it in tissue healing and things like that, the big problem when you're using this pathway on an ongoing basis, long term, is that you start creating blood pH changes. And as you start creating blood pH changes, you start creating more and more acid states of our bloodstream. And as we get further and further and further acidic, that starts having consequences for our overall health, in terms of our immune health, in terms of our oxygen utilization, and it's also in terms of energy production as well. So it has greater consequences for us. And even if we want to talk about broad scale, although it's not directly associated with this, Otto Warburg back in the 60s started talking about the link between acid, these pathways, and cancers even back then. And we're not saying that's what happens with cancer, just saying it's been spoken about for a long time how this affects our health. So the other option is to come in this pathway, which is this fat pathway. The good thing about the fat pathway is that fat does convert really well directly into acetyl-CoA without intermediate step, and it doesn't produce lactic acid in that process as well. So we can kind of get it straight in there and spin that around. The other great thing about it is that we have an endless store of fat. Even the leanest of leanest marathon runners in the world could still potentially produce somewhere in the order of 50 or 100,000 calories from stored fat. So you have a limitless availability of fat to put into this pathway as long as the pathway works effectively. All right, so how does exercise fit in with this? All right, so this is what we need to understand to begin with, is that when we are exercising, exercise is not about making muscles bigger. It's not about increasing your strength. It's not about getting fitter. What it really is about is improving these pathways. So you're either stimulating the top pathway or you're stimulating this other pathway. And it's about making them more efficient so they perform better, so that you're capable of performing better as well. That's really what exercise is all about if we break it down to a biochemical level. So there's a few key things we need to understand. So exercise is all about the energy you use. It's energy utilization. By pushing the system and stressing a pathway out, the body looks for better ways of doing it. And as it looks for better ways of doing it, it becomes more efficient. And as it becomes more efficient, then we know that these things, we start getting better performance because these pathways are working better. So it's also about increasing cellular performance. So if you put a stress on a pathway over and over and over again, the body will try and figure out a way to do it better. And this is cellular performance that we're talking about. And this is an increase. So we're kind of getting the cells functioning more efficiently, if you want to put it that way. And then we're also creating a better availability of cells as well. So if you have more cells that are capable of doing that same change and producing that energy, and they're running more efficiently, and when I say more cellular availability, I'm not necessarily talking about the cell itself, I'm talking about the enzymes and the things that are created inside that cell, then all of a sudden these pathways work more efficiently as well. So what exercise really is all about is about making your system run more efficiently. That's what it's all about, whether it be immune health, brain health, cardiovascular health. It's all about improving efficiencies so you don't have to work so hard, and it's all about keeping things under control, okay? So it becomes, the fitness is all about making life easier for yourself. That's really what we're talking about, reducing physiological stress. Okay, not stress as in cortisol stress or flight or fight. We're talking about each cellular stress. Okay, that's what it's about. Okay, so what happens if we constantly keep pushing hard? What about this no pain, no gain thing? You know what I mean? If we keep pushing and pushing and pushing and pushing and pushing and pushing, we start doing 6-7 hours worth of training a day and we keep pushing and pushing, what's the end result? So what you're really doing day in, day out is you're stimulating this pathway. Okay, we're stimulating this constant glucose pathway. We're putting high demands on this high pressure, no pain, no gain environment. You're constantly going what we call anaerobic, and we're really driving this pathway. So this pathway starts becoming more and more and more efficient and becomes a dominant pathway over our fat pathway, which is not really what we want. And again, I know we're keeping things very simplified, but that's generally not what we want. We want to have our fat pathways more efficient. They're the things that are generally associated with health. The other thing that happens with this is when you keep pushing this pathway around, you tend to activate the sympathetic nervous system. So your parasympathetic nervous system, which is the calming aspect of your nervous system, the relaxation, the laying on the beach, the walking through nature part of the nervous system, that really calms us down, that regulates our immune system, regulates our brain health, regulates our gut health. This is the system that loves long, slow endurance stuff. When we push hard, we're sprinting, we're pushing and pushing and pushing all the time, we tend to drive our sympathetic system, okay? And the problem with that is that that's our flight or fight responses, and most of our lives are already that way to begin with. So what we tend to do is we tend to propagate the problems for most of our lives and start pushing things further and further and further, and the net result of that long term is a changes in cortisol production. And cortisol is the main stress hormone we have. And the main reason we have that hormone, well, there's plenty of reasons, but one of the main reasons we have it from a flight or fight perspective is that it sensitizes the endings of our sympathetic nervous system to make them more efficient, okay? So these two go hand in hand together. And as we keep pushing it and pushing it and pushing it, the result is, again, higher levels of lactic acid production. So we start becoming more acidic. And we've already spoken about the health effects from that. And I've spoken about that in many other videos as well. You can go back and have a look through our database and look through that. And the result of that is that as this pathway becomes a dependent pathway, we become more and more and more glucose-centered. In other words, we become more dependent upon glucose as our main source of energy. And that, for a lot of people, not everybody, but for a lot of people, starts shifting them towards a carbohydrate-based diet, a carbohydrate-based mechanism. They start craving sugars and glucose and things like this on a regular basis, okay? And no, I'm not saying exercise will cause you to crave sugar. That's not where I'm going. I'm just saying when you do this long, 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 long term, the net result for a lot of people from what I've seen is that this pathway becomes dominant, and as it becomes more and more dominant, we start becoming more dependent upon that as our energy sources, and that often shifts people's diets that way, okay? The other thing with this as well, remember, is if you're activating a sympathetic nervous system, you're becoming more glucose dependent, means you're having higher levels of insulin production in the system as well, higher levels of cortisol production. The effect of all that, all up, is it shuts down our aerobic system. In other words, you start shutting this pathway down to an extent, which means you further become more and more and more and more glucose dependent. So how do we turn this around? How do we stop this from happening? It does not mean that you need to not do high intensity exercise, okay? I still do high intensity exercise as well. It's not something that you need to stop doing. What we're really talking about doing is having balance. And this is the real important thing that is forgotten about exercise. If you're taking a group of athletes, endurance athletes, you're gonna take them to run a marathon. The goal isn't, or even if you're doing footy and doing preseason, the goal isn't to go out and smash them on day one, yeah? We don't wanna be hurting people, we don't wanna get injured. You do a base building period first. We kind of let the system get used to exercise, let them build up, and then we start getting harder later on. And that is the mechanism which we need to work off. So what we generally do is we train this area first. We train that fat metabolism first. That's the key thing. We need to get our fat metabolism up and running first, so you've got the base to build from. And this gives you your endurance. This gives you your ability to do mileage. This gives you your ability to do distance. And then once we've got that, then we've got a level of ability to produce energy, and then we can start moving into a higher activity, a higher intensity type exercise. And whilst it may seem a lot slower to begin with, from my experience with working with athletes over years and years and years, this seems to be the easiest way to prevent injury and to get long-term change with where you want to be, okay? So we need to remember the key takeaways from this is exercise is about energy mechanisms and what are you stimulating right now and why are you doing it? It's about being cyclical with your activity, not being consistent the same period of time. So, you know, 3 months of aerobic base, predominantly 3 months of high intensity base, something like that. We also need to make sure that we're having enough recovery time. So if you've stressed out one of these pathways, you need to give yourself ample time to allow that system to recover. If it doesn't recover very well, then again, the result is going to be sympathetic activation, cortisol changes, activation of this pathway, and bang, we're back into the same part again. Okay, so if you have any questions on all this, we've kind of summarized this in a very, very, very simplified manner. If you have any questions with this at all, just reach out. I'm happy to help you out in any way we can. With regards to this stuff here, if you want some information, Melbourne Marathon now is, and that whole series, we're talking about 10K runs, half marathon, the full marathon, this is the time to get into or involved in it. We're about, give or take, about 20 weeks away from it. So if you want to get involved with it, I've offered to help a few people out in getting fit to do that. If you want to be involved with it, just post up the word marathon below. And I will get you into the program that I've written for you, which will basically allow you to hopefully complete those things with a whole lot of support from me and my team along the way as well. But anyway, guys, if you have any other questions with it, just message me. I'm happy to discuss with you how these pathways work in a bit more detail if you want, and other things that influence it. There's a whole lot of other things that influence it other than exercise. So please don't think that exercise is the only thing that's going to screw these pathways up. That's not the case at all. If you have any questions, message me. Otherwise, I shall catch up with the next bid. Bye for now. See you guys.